Hello students, so for today we are going to start a new topic, which is types of arc welding. What are the different types of fusion arc welding which are available? Later on we will also discuss the types of specialized welding process as well, which are categorized by AWS or American Welding Society. So before we move on to the types of welding, it is important for us to know what is manual, semi-automatic, machine and automatic welding. So according to ASME, American Society of Mechanical Engineering, section 9 gives requirement for the qualification of a welder. So basically, what is the definition of welder and what is the definition of welding operator? This is something which is going to help us understand manual, semi-automatic and automatic welding. So a welder is basically a person who performs manual or semi-automatic welding, and a welding operator is a person who operates a machine or automatic welding equipment. So now let us take a look at what is manual welding. So manual welding is basically a type of welding in which the entire welding is carried out by the hand. Okay, so using your hand, and then by using your hand you're carrying out all the welding operation. You're positioning the sample as well, and then you're carrying out the welding, controlling how much is the arc gap between the workpiece and the electrode, putting the filler wire separately as well, so controlling the feed of the filler as well, whether the feed is slow or whether the feed is very fast. So these are something which are controlled by the welder. So there are no mechanical device which are used. So one of the most common example is manual metal welding, or shield SMAW. Okay, so shielded metal arc welding or manual welding is basically a example, and also you can do gas tungsten arc welding manually as well. Next we move on to semi-automatic welding. So in semi-automatic welding, the equipment used controls the filler feed material. So basically there is an automatic equipment, and that automatic equipment is putting pressure, and basically it is feeding the filler wire at a rate which we have specified. So we can specify the filler feed rate, how the filler is fed into the welding torch, and this is called a wire feeder. Okay, the filler is basically a wire, and it is attached to a machine, and then that machine is basically feeding the wire. So this machine usually is controlled by servo motors. So the examples of this welding technique are flux core arc welding, gas metal arc welding and tungsten arc welding. However, the torch, you can see that the torch, the person is controlling the torch area manually. So the filler is automatic, but the torch is manually done. Next we move on to machine welding. So in machine welding is basically defined as welding done with equipment that has controls that can be adjusted by the welding operator. So usually the feed, you can see that the part is going to be fed automatically, the filler is going to be fed automatically. However, the welder is only standing, he is not touching the welding system, but he is controlling, he has got the controls, and on these controls he can basically change the feed rate, he can change the heat input, current, voltage, etc. So the welding operator may manually, during welding, as per configuration, he can control the mechanical and electronic devices. The example of such welding techniques are submerged arc welding, gas metal arc welding, also called MIG, flux core arc welding, and gas tungsten arc welding. So here you can see that in these types of welding, you can basically, when the torch is held mechanically and the feed of the filler is controlled electronically, the welding operators manually alter the parameters only when required to produce sound weld. So here is a picture of gas tungsten arc welding machine, and the operator is just looking at and controlling automatic welding machine. So in automatic welding machine, as you can see that you've got a robotic arm, and each and everything, the arc distance, okay, the filler feed, okay, the current and voltage, each and everything is automatic, and it is it is basically done by the robots. So there is no need for any welding operator. The welding operator does not require to control the parameters in this technique. So the example of this kind of welding is robotic welding, in which basically a program is stored before the welding and the operator just need to start the program. Loading and unloading may be done by the welding equipment. So the robots can basically load and unload the equipment as well, or anything which is required to be welded. So next we are going to move on to types of arc welding, including fusion liquid state welding. So when we talk about arc welding processes, there are seven major classification. Number one is shielded metal arc welding. Number two is TIG or gas tungsten arc welding. Number three is plasma arc welding or PAW. Number four is MAG or MIG or GMAW, gas metal arc welding. Number five is flux core arc welding. It is also called self-shielded arc welding. Number six is submerged arc welding or SAW and electrogas EGAW welding. So let's take a start at shielded metal arc welding, SMAW. Shielded metal arc welding is also called MMAW because what you're doing is you are manually doing the welding process. So you have the electrode and the filler material together, and then you are carrying out the welding process manually with your hand. So that is why it is called manual metal arc welding. So you've got this electrode, okay, and on this electrode you've got a covering of flux. Okay, the function of flux is basically to protect the molten pool. This is your molten pool here. Okay, this is your molten pool. So the function of this flux is to protect, okay, to protect the molten pool from oxidation. Okay, so it is going to protect the molten pool as well as the arc. So the gas generated by the flux, okay, are going to protect the arc as well. Okay, so it has got two major functions, the flux. So the flux core means that the wire is basically the core and flux is the outer region. So that is why it's coated flux. And we have got another type which is called flux core arc welding that we will look later on. However, in this case, in manual metal arc welding, the flux is coated on the filler material or on the electrode, because electrode is consumable. This is a consumable electrode. So the flux helps us in getting a stable arc, and it helps deoxidize and shield the weld metal. So the process uses different types of transformer, and that transformer has drooping characteristics. We will look into it later on when we will study about electrical characteristics later on. The constant current at variable voltage can be given in this type of shielded metal arc welding. When an electrode is ignited, arc melted, the flux, the electrode core wire and base metal. So when the electrode is ignited, it melts three things. Number one, flux. Number two, the core wire, and number three, the base material. And then the electrode or the filler material is deposited onto our plate. So the advantages is that, okay, the machine cost is very low cost. It is portable. I can take it here and there. Because it is manual metal arc welding, so I can take the filler material, my electrode with me together. Those sticks, so it is also called stick welding, because that those sticks we can carry here and there in many places. So but the most important thing is that the person who is going to carry out the welding, he or she should have very calm and smooth hands, and he or she should be very skilled. So some of the disadvantage is that once you are doing the welding, then the electrode will consume slowly, and then we have to throw away the stick, and then we have to grab another stick, and then we have to start welding again. So this is one of the disadvantage. Electrode is wasted. Weld bead need to be thoroughly cleaned. So there is a lot of slag which is deposited. So once the slag is deposited, then we have to use slag hammer to remove the slag material. Slag is basically flux material which was burned during the welding process, and then it was deposited onto the shielded metal arc welded sample. It is a slow process, okay, and it is a manual process, so everything has to be done manually. But the application is that you can take it anywhere, and then it is very multi-purpose. So it has got these advantages as well. So here you will look into a video of shielded metal arc welding.
Welding, or SMAW. You may also hear this process called manual metal arc welding, or MMA welding. Some people refer to this process simply as arc welding, but shielded metal arc welding, or stick welding, is just one of many types of arc welding. In stick welding, an electric current flows through a metal electrode or stick. An arc forms between the end of this electrode and the workpiece. The arc melts both the metal in the rod and the metal in the pieces to be joined. The metal from the electrode is ejected into a molten weld pool and mixes or coalesces with the workpiece. The metal in the workpiece is called the base metal, and the metal added to the joint from the electrode is called filler metal. Stick welding always adds filler metal to the joint. Because the electrode is constantly melting away and becoming part of the welded structure, stick welding is known as a consumable electrode process. As the electrode is heated by the arc, some of the covering on the electrode releases protective gases that shield the weld and help stabilize the arc. The remaining covering melts and covers the molten weld pool with a protective slag layer. This slag layer protects and helps shape the weld as it solidifies, but it must be removed when the weld is cool. Since the gases generated by the flux covering are able to completely protect the molten weld, there is no need for other shielding equipment such as high-pressure gas cylinders, regulators, or hoses. Compared to other welding processes, stick welding equipment is often very simple. Sometimes the only controls on the machine are current and polarity. Many important welding variables come from how the person doing the welding positions and moves the electrode. For this reason, the quality of welds produced by this process depends greatly on operator skill. In stick welding, two insulated wires are connected to the welding machine. One lead goes to a clamp, which is connected to the work. This is called the work lead. The other wire goes to an electrode holder. The uncovered or grip end of the electrode is placed into the electrode holder. The polarity of the welding setup refers to how the electricity flows from the machine to the workpiece and back. The current will either be AC or DC. In AC, or alternating current, the direction of the flow of the electricity changes directions many times every second. Direct current, or DC, is like the flow of electricity from a car battery. One lead is always positive and the other is always negative. DC can be set up two ways in stick welding. One way to connect DC is DCEN, or DC electrode negative, which is often called straight polarity. In DCEN, the electrode is connected to the negative terminal and the work is connected to the positive. The other way to connect DC is DCEP, which is DC electrode positive, often called reverse polarity. Many stick welding electrodes operate on DCEP, but some are designed to work with DCEN or AC, so check the manufacturer's recommendations for the proper settings. Stick electrodes are made with a variety of metal alloy compositions and flux chemistries. You'll want to make sure the electrode you plan to use will be strong enough and that it's compatible with the base metal and the position of the joint you want to weld. Often, electrodes have the American Welding Society classification code printed on them. This code will identify tensile strength, the flux covering type, the appropriate welding positions, and sometimes other important information. So
we move on to gas tungsten arc welding. Gas tungsten arc welding is also known as TIG, or tungsten inert gas welding, because we are basically putting an inert gas, shielding gas, into a nozzle, and then that nozzle basically creates a jet of shielding gas across the electrode. Okay, so this is our electrode, and to shield the electrode we are basically putting some shielding gases. Now the shielding gas can be argon, helium, or a mixture of these types of gases, and the weld area and the electrode are protected from oxidation or from atmospheric contamination by an inert shielding gas. So the electrode is called tungsten electrode, and this electrode is non-consumable, NC, or non-consumable. It means that the electrode will not melt, it is only providing heat energy, it is only providing electric arc. Next, the filler material is added either manually by hand or automatically by a machine. Okay, so what is going to happen is that the person is going to control the shielding torch. This whole system is called a shielding torch, and the filler material is manually or automatically added. So if the person or the worker is basically controlling the torch, okay, however the filler material is added manually, then this whole system is called manual welding. However, if the filler material is added automatically with the help of a wire feeding machine, okay, then this whole system will be called semi-automatic, because one process or one part of the process is automatic. So in this process, basically the tungsten electrode is used. When ignited arc from electrode will melt the workpiece, and it will melt the filler material. So the filler material is deposited by dipping the filler material into the melt pool. So the advantages are that it helps in welding aluminium and stainless steel. As you guys remember, we carried out DCEN and DCEP, direct current electrode positive. So when we inverse the polarity, it helps remove the aluminium oxide or alumina layer which is deposited on aluminium. So this is one of the examples. AC current in gas tungsten arc welding is suitable for welding aluminium because AC current produces cleaning action. So what happens is that you can use alternating current as well. Okay, here you have got a sample, and then you are using alternating current. So some part of it is basically electrode negative and some part of it is electrode positive. So it's not DC, it's only AC, electrode negative and positive alternating. So what happens is that these positive and negative cycle, they remove the layer, and also it help us get a good amount of penetration when the electrode is negative. When the electrode is positive, it helps us remove the alumina or Al2O3 layer. So shielding gas can be argon, helium. Okay, it gives very good penetration and protection. It can be mechanized, so you can make it automatic or semi-automatic as well. However, when you are using it manually, then a very, very skilled worker is required. It is used very well for aluminium and stainless steel application. So these are two material for which gas tungsten arc welding is specifically used, because stainless steel also from a chromium layer. Okay, so that is why a protective chromium layer has to be broken, and then we have to melt the material. So here is a video for gas tungsten arc welding process.
What is TIG welding? TIG stands for tungsten inert gas welding. The American Welding Society calls this process gas tungsten arc welding, or GTAW. You might also hear it called heli-arc welding. TIG welding uses a tungsten electrode, and tungsten has an extremely high melting point. When you TIG weld, the electrode gets hot, but it doesn't melt. We say that it's a non-consumable electrode. That doesn't mean it lasts forever. That just means that it doesn't melt and become part of the weld. You see, in a lot of other welding processes, the electrode melts and becomes filler metal. Those are consumable electrode processes. So here's the tungsten electrode being held in a TIG torch. The electrode slips into a collet, and the collet tightens up against the collet body. You can adjust the length that the electrode sticks out of the holder by loosening up the end cap. When you tighten the end cap, the collet clamps down on the electrode. TIG works by melting the base metal, and that is the metal that makes up the two pieces that are to be joined. The heat is generated by an electric arc that forms between the base metal and the tungsten electrode. You can control the amount of heat with a foot pedal or with a thumb wheel on the torch. For most metals, the current is direct current, or DC. DC is like the current flowing from a car battery. One wire is always the negative and one is always the positive. In DC TIG welding, the electrode is usually negative and the workpiece is positive. term DCEN is used for this, indicating that the current is DC and the electrode is negative. This is also called straight polarity, but DCEN is a more descriptive term. DCEN puts most of the heat on the workpiece, and it's the most common setup. When welding aluminum, however, AC is used. In AC, the positive and negative voltages switch back and forth between the electrode and the workpiece. This puts more heat on the electrode, but it has a cleaning effect on the workpiece. You see, aluminum forms oxides that float to the top of the weld pool and prevent a good weld. AC current helps control these oxides. In an electric circuit, the current flows in a loop. In TIG welding, the current has to flow in a complete circle from the machine to the torch, into the work, and back to the machine. A work lead is clamped to the work to complete the circuit from the workpiece back to the machine. Now, you can TIG weld with or without filler metal, and that's not a choice you have in a lot of other processes. If you want to add filler metal to a TIG weld, you use a filler rod, which is just a rod of metal with a specific alloy. You want to make sure that the filler metal you're using is compatible with the base metal and that it has the strength required to do the job. In TIG welding, the molten metal is protected by a shielding gas. This gas, usually argon and sometimes helium or other gases, keeps the molten metal from reacting with oxygen, water vapor in the atmosphere. This shielding gas is stored in high-pressure cylinders like these. The pressure is reduced to a usable level by a device called a regulator. The shielding gas flows through a hose and comes out right at the point of the weld. So in summary, TIG welding is an electric arc welding process. It uses a non-consumable tungsten electrode. The filler metal is added separately in the form of filler rod, and the shielding gas comes from a high-pressure cylinder.
So when we look about tungsten inert gas welding, there are effective polarity, which you have discussed already, which is DCEN and DCEP. The function of DCEP is the cleaning action, whereas the function of DCEN is the welding action. So here are basically the DCEN, which is basically creating a melt pool. Okay, it is basically creating a deeper melt pool, whereas DCEP is basically removing the oxide film away from the aluminium or iron oxides are being removed. Here you can see that the melting point of alumina is around 2000 degrees and iron oxide is around 1500 degrees. So tungsten inert gas welding can also be, we can supply the power in terms of modulation or pulse frequencies. Okay, so what happens is that you change the waveform of the electric current, which is basically being provided to the electrode and the workpiece. So when you provide different pulses, and you can change the duration between each pulse, okay, and you can change the total amount of peak current. This is called IP, peak current. This is the average current which is provided. This is I, average. So these are, and this is the baseline current which always remains active. So what happens is that when you use and when you don't use pulse, then it has a significant characteristics of the weld which is formed. Okay, here you can see that there is no pulse used. So the arc is basically, there is some kind of arc blow, okay, and you can see that the molten pool is also not very stable, or the weld bead is not very stable. However, once you improve and once you put frequencies, their frequency is basically the distance between each pulse, okay. So once you add some amount of frequency, then what happens is that you can stabilize the arc much better and you can get a better weld bead. So at 250 hertz you can see that the arc is much more stable, okay, and the amount of weld bead appearance, weld seam appearance is also very nice and very good. So here you can see that the filler material is deposited, or the molten or the melting occurs in the form of these weld seams. Next we move on to plasma arc welding. Plasma arc welding basically is an arc welding process which is similar to gas tungsten arc welding GTAW. However, there are some differences. The electric arc is formed between an electrode and the workpiece. So you've got the electrode and then you've got the workpiece. This is very common, right? So the electric arc is formed between the electrode and the workpiece. However, the key difference from gas tungsten arc welding is that the electrode is positioned within the body of the torch. So you've got another body, okay, and this body is basically shielding the electrode from the gas nozzle. So I've got a gas nozzle, okay, this is a gas nozzle, a shielding gas nozzle, and I'm protecting the electrode from this gas nozzle, and I am putting another gas which is called the plasma gas separately. So this helps us stabilize and constrict the plasma only in that region due to the nozzle, and that arc is protected by the shielding gas nozzle which I am going to provide separately. So the difference between GTAW and plasma arc welding is that the electrode is positioned within the body of the torch so that the plasma arc is separated from the shielding gas envelope. The plasma is then forced through a fine bore copper nozzle. So this plasma is within a copper CU nozzle. Okay, it is very fine. So the more fine or more thinner is the diameter, the more the arc will be constricted, or it will be very narrow. When the arc is very narrow, then what happens is that when I'm going to do the welding, it is going to produce a very deeper penetration because the arc is very constricted. The heat energy is very high within a very small area. The arc is constricted, so the amount of melting or penetration will be very high. So this copper nozzle constricts the arc and the plasma exits the orifice at very high velocities. So the velocity by which the plasma flows or the arc flows is also very high, approaching a temperature of around 28,000 degrees. So in a plasma arc welding, 28,000 degrees can be obtained, or 50,000 Fahrenheit or higher can be obtained, because of the fact that we are separately putting an electrode in an orifice and a separate shielding gas is basically given. Now plasma arc welding can be different types. We have microplasma, okay, based on the currents, medium plasma and keyhole plasma. So keyhole plasma is basically the fact that you produce a keyhole, okay, type of weld bead appearance onto the welding, and this creates a very strong or deep joint. So keyhole based types of welding are welding which produces very deep joint, and once you are moving, this is the moment of your electrode, as you move away you create a keyhole like this slowly as well. So this is why some of the weld bead look like this also. So plasma are usually hotter than TIG in shielded metal arc welding. The weld is cleaner, it can very well very thick material. So you can, if you have a sheet of 25 millimeter, it can weld 25 mm sheet also. It can penetrate fully until the root area. This is the lower part is called the root area, and it can penetrate the root area as well. So the disadvantage is that the machine and the nozzle cost is very high, and application are that it is specially used for aluminium and stainless steel. So in the next, we are going to look at a video for plasma arc welding process.
In plasma arc welding, metal coalescence is produced by a constricted arc made up of a high velocity stream of ionized gas called a plasma. In most plasma arc welding operations, the plasma jet is generated by heating the orifice gas in the torch pollenum chamber to a plasma and forcing the plasma to exit through a constricting nozzle or orifice. Partial shielding is obtained from the plasma and is supplemented by an auxiliary shielding gas. Auxiliary shielding gases used include argon, helium, or mixtures of argon with hydrogen or helium. Because of the constricted arc, the heat energy of the plasma stream is concentrated and extremely intense. This permits deep penetration, narrow welds, and rapid welding speeds with good arc stability. Work pieces can be joined with or without filler metal. plasma arc welding can be used to join most ferrous and non-ferrous metals, including extremely thin materials such as foils. Plasma arc welding equipment cost is high, however, so the process is often limited in its application.
So there is a difference in plasma arc welding and tungsten inert gas welding. The difference are that plasma arc welding is basically an advanced form of tungsten inert gas welding. In case of TIG, you can see that the arc is exposed and it is open, okay? And then it is only shielded by the argon gas or the helium gas. Whereas in plasma, we have got a separate orifice gas, and this plasma is basically, or this electrode is protected, and it is less exposed to the shielding gas. Now the plasma used a special torch where the nozzle is used to constrict the arc. So here you can see that the arc is constricted because of the orifice. Here the arc is constricted due to the orifice. And in TIG, the arc is like an expanded kind of arc where it is more diverse or diverged. Now the arc is constructed with the help of a water-cooled small diameter nozzle. So this is a very small nozzle, and it is sometimes water-cooled as well because the temperature, as I said, goes to 50,000 Fahrenheit. Now this water-cooled small diameter nozzle squeezes the arc and increases its pressure. So the pressure increases and the temperature also increases, which enhances the heat transfer characteristics, and it produces a good stability in the arc, and it produces basically a nice arc shape, and this arc shape is very penetrating. It produces a very larger depth of penetration. Now plasma arc form using gas in two forms. This gas can either be laminar or it can be turbulent. It depends on the application that we want to like. So for turbulent, we put very high pressure gas and it has a very high flow rate Q, whereas for laminar, the pressure and flow rate both are less. So here you can see we've got a plasma arc welding, and it is producing a keyhole, and it has already basically penetrated the whole sample completely, and a keyhole is produced. Here you can see that initially that the penetration is very wide. However, you can see that it has fully penetrated the sample, and it looks like basically a keyhole. You are entering a key. So this is the top side, okay, and this is the back side. Back side is also fully penetrated, and a very nice and sound metal or sound weld metal has been obtained. So the outstanding characteristics of plasma arc welding is because of its exceptional penetration power of plasma jet, and it is its ability to weld 2.5 mm to 25 mm of plate. So the major advantage of keyhole technique is to penetrate rapidly through relatively thick root section. So this section is a root section. It is quite thick, and we can penetrate that thick root section and to produce uniform bead without mechanical backing. So the bead is also very uniform. This is the bead, and it is very, very uniform. So this is all about plasma arc welding. However, it is a bit expensive. Next, we move on to gas metal arc welding, also called MIG welding. In MIG welding, we use a transformer which has a constant voltage transformer. We will look into this once we go through electrical characteristics or electrical power characteristic. Now, gas metal arc welding is semi-automatic process because the metal is basically fed automatically. However, we have to basically control the feed of the our work metal or our job. So our job has to be basically moved and at a constant feed or at a certain feed rate, something like that. In metal transfer, we have the option to go for three types: short circuit, globular, and spray transfer. This is something that you have gone through already. So in MIG, we have the option to control all of these things. And for all of these things, we have different applications. So short circuit has different application, globular has different. It is for faster material deposit, and spray transfer has also different. So spray transfer is usually applicable for thick metals and carbon steel material. So in MIG or MAG or GMAW, okay, you can use active gas or inert gas as a combination. So if you are using a combination of argon and carbon dioxide, or carbon dioxide or argon and oxygen, then it is called metal active gas, gas metal arc welding. And if you are using inert gas, then it is called metal inert gas welding, where you have argon and some small portion of oxygen could be added. So here you can see, if you are using 100% CO2, then the bead width of the weld bead, if I am going to draw the weld bead, then the width is very high. Okay, this is the width. And if I use argon and only less percentage of oxygen, then obviously this width is going to reduce. However, the penetration depth increases with the usage of argon. And if you use 100% argon, then basically a larger depth is obtained. So what is gas metal arc welding? You're going to see into this video.
What is MIG welding? MIG stands for metal inert gas welding. The American Welding Society calls this process gas metal arc welding, or GMAW. You might also hear it called wire welding. In MIG welding, a thin wire acts as the electrode. This wire is fed from a spool mounted on a gun or inside the welding machine through a flexible tube and out of the nozzle on the welding gun or torch. The wire is fed continuously when the trigger on the welding gun is pulled. When this trigger is pulled, it also switches on the welding current and a shielding gas. An electric arc forms between this wire electrode and the workpiece and heats both metals above their melting point. These metals mix together or coalesce and solidify to join the workpieces into a single piece. The metal in these parts to be joined is called the base metal, and the metal that comes from the melting wire electrode is called filler metal. MIG welding always adds filler metal to the joint. Because the wire electrode melts as it's being used, MIG is called a consumable electrode process. Here's the MIG wire going through the wire feeder into a flexible tube or conduit liner. The liner goes through the hose or welding lead all the way to the torch nozzle. At the nozzle, the wire is fed through a contact tip and comes out at the point of the weld. Shielding gas is also fed through the welding lead. It goes through a gas diffuser and flows out of the nozzle. This shielding gas, which is often a mix of argon and CO2, protects the molten metal from reacting with oxygen, water vapor, and other things in the atmosphere. The shielding gas is stored in high-pressure cylinders like these. The pressure is reduced to a usable level by a device called a regulator. In MIG welding, all the machine controls are set on the machine itself. The most important of these are polarity, wire speed, and voltage. The trigger on the gun is just an on-off switch. For most MIG welding, the current is direct current, or DC. DC is like the current flowing from a car battery. One wire is always the negative, and one is always positive. In DC MIG welding, the electrode is usually positive and the workpiece is negative. The term DCEP is used, indicating that the current is direct current and the electrode is positive. This is also called reverse polarity, but DCEP is a more descriptive term. In an electric circuit, the current flows in a loop. In MIG welding, the current has to flow in a complete circle from the machine to the torch, into the work, and back to the machine. A work lead is clamped to the work to complete the circuit from the workpiece back to the machine. So, in summary, MIG welding is an electric arc welding process. It uses a consumable wire electrode. Filler metal is added automatically. And the shielding gas comes.
So gas metal arc welding, MIG, MAG, can be used as pulsed as well. So pulsing is basically used to enhance the weld bead quality and improve the dropping characteristics or deposition characteristics of our weld. So next we move on to submerged arc welding. Submerged arc welding is basically a process of joining in which involves the formation of an electric arc between a continuously fed electrode. So basically the electrode, which is the wire, is basically fed continuously, but in front of or ahead of wire we are depositing flux onto the material. So this is my plate that I want to weld, okay, and before I do the welding, I first deposit some amount or some portion of flux, and then this welding wire is going to get into the flux and then the welding is carried out. So that is why this wire or this electrode is submerged in the granular flux, and this granular flux is fed through a flux feeding tube. So this helps in enhancing the quality of the weld bead very well. You can see that the weld bead has almost very nice appearance because of the fact that it has was submerged, the gases, the oxidation products, the contamination, okay, the gases could not enter. Okay, so this helped produce a very nice beads. A blanket of powder flux surrounds, so you can see that this is a blanket of powdered flux, and this surrounds the weld metal completely. It covers the arc, so the arc is also covered. This is the arc, this is covered. And when the molten pool provides electrical conduction between the metal to be joined and electrode. So this is basically also an automatic kind of a automatic welding type. So a process of mechanized welding process, okay, arc submerged in the molten flux. Advantage are that you can go for very high speed, we can weld very thick material, can use wire with large diameter. I can use single wire, I can use multiple wire also, so I can put three wires together as well. So this is to increase the amount of metal which is deposited onto the material and increase the deposition efficiency or amount of deposition onto the weld metal. So these are some of the advantages for submerged arc welding. Taking advantage of both SMAW and GMAW, so it is basically looks like a combination. Its productivity is higher than gas metal arc welding. The disadvantage is that you have to weld in flat position only. Why? Because the flux is fed by gravity, okay, and it only goes down. So you can only do the welding in flat position, which I told you guys is this position. From top you are doing the welding flat, okay. So the fabrication of linear welding for large product is something which are the application of this submerged arc welding process. So next you are going to look at a video of submerged arc welding process.
SAW, or submerged arc welding, is a welding process using a wire under a solid flux protection. The entire welding operation is done under flux protection with no spatters, no visible arc, and is also limited to flat or horizontal joints. In comparison with GMAW, SAW uses larger diameter wires with very high current. This process is generally used to weld thick parts and on applications requiring high deposition rate. It can be used in direct current with a positive electrode. For larger deposits, it is also possible to use twin wires, where two wires are fed into the joint using the same power source. Another configuration is to feed multiple wires, commonly known as tandem twin, where one welding head uses direct current to feed one wire into the joint, while another head feeds two wires using alternative current. Direct current is not used on both welding head to diminish the magnetic field interaction produced by both